Believe that our organ is not going to sound like that from after Debbie's departure. So I'm sure you're all wondering who I am and why I'm up here. Some of you know my name is Thene Martin. I've been a member here for more than 15 years. Reverend Michael returns from his family leave tomorrow. Reverend Mike, who you expected to see here today, came down with COVID after his trip to the Philippines, and I'm happy to report that his symptoms have resolved, and he has tested negative once. He's hoping to test negative again today, and he'll be back with us next week, and I'm sure that he's with us on Zoom today. So welcome, everyone. I'm so happy to see so many people here to celebrate celebrate Debbie. Welcome to everyone on Zoom and Facebook Live. And with that, I will turn it over to our liturgist, Casey. Thank you.
All right. Good morning, Pilgrim. Can everyone rise in body and spirit as they're able to join me in the call to worship? Make a joyful noise to our God, all the earth.
Michael wanted to do an intro before. It's not
in the bulletin.
Okay.
Sorry.
No worries.
Make a joyful noise to our God, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to God with the lyres and the sound of melody. With trumpets and the sound of the horn, make a joyful noise to our sovereign, our God. Let the sea roar with all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills together enjoy the presence of our God.
Say your praise.
And please join me in this morning's invocation. God, we want so much to see you, to understand your ways and your hopes for us. We cannot see you directly, but we can feel your loving presence as we gather together in this place. May our fellowship, our prayer, our reflection, and our music draw us ever closer to you and inspire us to do your will in all things. Amen.
My soul. shall bow in humble adoration, and I will be my heaven alone.
Michael usually does. Thumbs up if you're feeling good, thumbs down if you're not so good, thumbs in the middle if you're in the middle. So how are you feeling today? Okay. Do you guys want to come a little bit closer so you can see? Let's go this way. There you go. And your brother too. So nice. Yeah, okay, great. All right, awesome. Okay. I'm noticing something that I don't usually see when we have the message for children and youth. What did you all bring today? Why? Are we going on a field trip?
No.
So why do you have your backpacks with you today? Just to carry them around?
No, we did rehearse.
Uh-oh, we might have to change your name to Forgetful Jones. So why did the rest of you bring your backpacks? Is something happening this week? Okay, and why are we doing a backpack blessing? Oh my goodness, tomorrow is the first day of school. How do you feel about that? You feel good? You feel good about it too? Okay, anybody else?
I feel like this.
Kind of feel in the middle, like not really excited, but not really not excited. You feel excited to go, okay? Does anybody feel a little bit nervous about going back to school? Does anybody feel sad about going back to school? Say it again.
I'm sad about the pool closing.
Oh, you're sad about the pool closing. I know. That usually happens at the end of the summer.
Me too.
So is it closing today, or do you still have next weekend to go?
Next Saturday.
Okay, good. Well, no matter how you feel, if you're feeling excited, if you're feeling a little bit nervous, like, oh, I'm going to a new school, or I don't know who's going to be in my class. It's a brand new teacher that I didn't have before. It's okay. It's okay if you have those feelings, and it's good to share them with your mom or your dad or somebody in your family so that they can know how you're feeling. Okay. right now, I am going to give each of you something special to put inside your book pack, your backpack. It's a backpack tag, and it's something that you can keep in there, and it just to remind you that God has your back.
Okay, go ahead, it's carrying the bus. I'm going to put that on the back. Why did you give money?
Excuse me?
Someone gave money.
So, no, I don't have any money to give you, sorry. That would be a really awesome thing to have to put in your book bag. Okay. And
I have it in my book bag. It's right there.
Awesome. That's a wonderful place to put it. He put it in the back where there's a little window on the back of his backpack. Yeah. So that's a great place to put it too if you want to put it there. Okay. So I want you to listen because I want all of you to this school year be curious and be kind. Be gentle, but be strong too. And be brave, have courage to try new things, and always remember to be loving. Okay, guys. Okay, now, who likes to get a gift? Okay, yeah, and right now we're going to have a blessing, which is a special gift. So I'm going to ask you to put your hands out in front of you, like you're getting ready to receive a gift. And think about, you can, if you want to close your eyes while I'm talking, you can do that. And just think about the words that I'm going to tell you. May these tags remind you that God is always with you as you sit and as you stand, as you learn and as you play, in every fear and every celebration, may you know God, your friend, is always with you. Sammy, I'm going to ask you to sit over here, please.
Thank you.
All right, and now I'm going to begin a prayer before we go to Sunday school. And some of it I'm going to ask you to listen, and then some of it I'll tell you when you should repeat after me. Okay, so let's pray. God of fresh starts and new beginnings, we bring ourselves, our big feelings, and our backpacks to you. In our backpacks, we carry blank pages, sharpened pencils, pointy crayons. And in our hearts, we carry big feelings, unanswered questions, and hopeful expectations. There are endless possibilities of what this new year might bring, of what we might learn, who we might meet, and who we might become. Okay, now repeat after me. God, our friend who is always with us, be with us through it all.
Be with us as we ride the bus.
Be with us as we walk.
Be with us as we buckle our seatbelts,
zip up our jackets,
and tie our shoes.
However we get there,
and whatever we wear,
from wherever we live.
Bless this journey into something new.
Bless this journey into something wild.
For the grown-ups going back to school. Yeah, because we have some grown-ups that are going back to school too. All of our teachers. With us, God. Be with them too. Thank you for our teachers.
Thank you for our teachers.
Helpers.
Helpers.
Caregivers.
Caregivers.
And leaders.
And leaders.
And for all they do.
For all they do.
To help us learn and grow.
To help us learn and grow.
God, our friend who's full of wonder.
God, our friends full of wonder.
Fill their hearts and bless their hands.
Fill their hearts and bless their hands.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. We're going to have Sunday school and we're going to walk
to the Sunday school room.
Thank you.
And this morning's scripture reading comes from 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verses 11 through 14. Now, when the priests came out of the holy place, for all the priests who were present had sanctified themselves without regard to their divisions, all the Levitical singers, Asaph, Heman, and Judathan, their sons and kindred, arrayed in fine linen with cymbals, harps, and lyres, stood east of the altar with 120 priests who were trumpeters. It was the duty of the trumpeters and singers together to make themselves heard in unison in praise and thanksgiving to God. And when the song was raised with the trumpets and cymbals and other musical instruments in praise to God, for God is good, for God's steadfast love endures forever. The house of God was filled with a cloud so that the priests could not stand to minister because of the cloud. For the glory of God filled the house of God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And now to Thene.
When I first learned that I'd be preparing the sermon for today, I have to admit I panicked a little bit. Then I did what any former lawyer would do. I did my research. I compiled lists of biblical passages about music, read scholarly articles about the Psalms, and watched endless YouTube videos from UCC churches on the topic of music ministry. I took copious notes and outlined different directions in which I might go, starting with pen and paper, but then turning to my laptop after my wastebasket overfloweth with discarded first drafts. After my husband reminded me that perfect is the enemy of the good, I forged ahead. In any event, Reverend Mike asked me to keep it to 3 or 4 minutes, so I will save my research for another day. Of course, I'm not a seminarian or even a seasoned public speaker, but like you, I love music. As a child, I was in the band, in the choir. I marched with a bass clarinet. I went to band camp and I studied piano all the way through college. In our home, my father had stereo speakers taller than I was, the very same speakers that were used in a local movie theater, and our house was filled with music of every genre. Now I listen to music at home, in the car, on a plane, everywhere. And I love to see live performances of all kinds. Music provides the soundtrack of our lives, moving us in a way that no other art form does. A familiar song can stir memories that transport us in time. As children, we learn about God's love through music. Before we can read, we've already become familiar with Bible stories and scripture through singing. Beyond instruction, music is an important means by which God's presence is made real to us during our services. To quote Reverend Gregory Brewer, I had to get a little research in here, worshiping through music changes and transforms us. It inclines our hearts to God in ways other forms can't accomplish. It strengthens us, convicts us, builds us up, and even restores us. In other words, when we sing and devote our whole selves to God, something godly happens within us. When I first visited Pilgrim Church in 2006, it felt like coming home. It had been decades since I'd attended church regularly, but having grown up in the UCC, everything was familiar. The service structure, the children's message, but most significantly, the music. Now, I don't recall which hymns were sung that day, but I knew them, just as the words to the doxology came so easily. And with that recognition, I felt a connection both to the people in the sanctuary and to God. The passing years have only strengthened those connections. On any given Sunday, from the prelude to the postlude, the introit, the anthem, the hymns, the doxology, and the offertory and communion accompaniments, listening attentively or singing in community, something profound and sacred takes place here. This is a bittersweet day as we celebrate Debbie's retirement and wish her all the best. Michael Santana and others will have much more to say, but on a personal note, I'm so grateful to have enjoyed the music here at Pilgrim under Debbie's direction. Some of you may know that I took piano lessons with her until the pandemic onset, and I am awed by her talent, both as a performer and an instructor. Debbie, I also value your friendship. We've been blessed spiritually by Debbie's loving and gifted presence for a very long time. She's added immensely to our lives, and her wonderful influence will be with us always. Thank you, Debbie.
We come now to our time of offering. We have so much to be grateful for, so many reasons to give God thanks and praise. Let us take this moment to give back to our church, to our community, and to the world. You can give by placing your offering in the plate as it comes around, by sending a check directly to the church office, or by donation online via Zelle. As we have been so richly blessed, let us also seek to be a blessing to others. Your morning offering will now be received. God, for giving us these gifts to share. Our time, our talents, our labor, and our treasure. Consecrate them, O God, and us as well, so that we may become a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you. Amen.
Now is the time in our service when prayer requests are made. Is there anyone who'd like to have us pray? Joy?
I would ask for prayers for my sorority sister. She lost her father on Wednesday, and so she's lost both of her parents in less than a year. Her mother died in November, and now her father has passed. So I'd ask for prayers for Sherelle. I would also ask for prayers for my mother's sister. My mother, for those of you that don't know, my mother has twin sisters. They were older than she was. And the oldest twin just got out of the hospital yesterday. So prayers for Joan.
Prayers for a dear friend of mine, Jill. Her husband suffered a stroke and brain bleed. He's in ICU at Suburban, and it's very early on, so they don't know what the prognosis is yet. So prayers for Paul. Paul's the one in the hospital. Thank you.
I would just ask that we pray for continued healing for Reverend Mike. Healing also for Lisa Gotti, who came back from Norway with a terrible head cold. And I'd also ask for personal prayers for me as I traveled back to Minnesota tomorrow to take my mother back to the Mayo. Is there anything on Zoom or Facebook? No? Oh, Devin.
Prayers of gratitude for my grandpa's 83rd birthday, who celebrated this past week, and her 13th birthday.
I'd like to add three other birthdays to that list. This past week, Debbie celebrated her birthday, Patty celebrated her birthday, and my daughter Katie also celebrated her birthday. So just mentally put them, we're going to sing it again? Okay, let's sing it again.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Penny?
We have one prayer request from Zoom. Evie. Quite sure EBI who that is, but he says, please pray for my husband. He was hospitalized at the VA this week. Our son Ellis misses his dad. That was from Ebony, and Ebony. Her husband's in the VA hospital.
So we'll pray for Ebony's husband in the hospital. Thank you. All right, now if you'll join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As usual, on the fourth page of the bulletin, there are a few announcements. The next newsletter comes out Thursday, September 7th, so please get your articles to Katie no later than Tuesday, September 5th. Homecoming Sunday is September 10th, and on behalf of Worship Board, I hope that you'll all make it. We've got lots of fun things planned for that Sunday. And as I mentioned earlier, Reverend Michael's parental leave, this leg of it will end tomorrow. He'll be back in the office tomorrow. Are there any other announcements for the church community? Chris.
Just the manna market for September, it didn't get in the bulletin. You should see it next week, but it is in the newsletter. We're signing up for the next manna market, which will be Monday, September 17th. We need about 6 to 8 people per shift. Thanks.
Any other announcements? Okay, now for what we've all been waiting for, the celebration of Debbie Houston. Michael, can I turn it over to you?
Do I come to where you are?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, great. Right, so we're going to say something embarrassing. Good morning, all. What a wonderful and bittersweet day, as has already been said. I wanted to tell you a little bit about my experiences with Debbie and to let you know that I actually knew her before we met. And that comes because of Rose Bellow. Some of you here may remember Rose Bellow was the choir director before I arrived, and she passed away 20 years ago next month. And so it's been an even 20 years. But the thing that I remember is Rose worked for me at Suitland, and she was going through chemotherapy at a time for her cancer. And she came home and she was staying with Debbie. And I couldn't understand why she was staying with Debbie to go through her chemo. Why not your family or friends or whatever? And then I realized that it's this church. It's this wonderful church that offers so much and so many things. And Debbie has been treated so well by this church, I think, over the years, and so I want to make sure that I said that, my first encounter with her. Well, to continue along with that, Rose Bellow had a memorial service, as many of you remember who were here and who attended, and I conducted her memorial service. Well, we had our very first rehearsal for that service, and the choir was very ambitious. Very ambitious. And I remember working on things with the choir and smiling and thinking, this is going to be very interesting. It's too ambitious. And I went to Debbie after rehearsal. I said, there's no way we can sing this piece of music at Rose's funeral. It happened to be the Brahms Requiem, the How Lovely Is Thy Dwelling Place. And I thought, oh, no, no, there's just no way. And Debbie turned to me and said, don't worry. This choir will go home and practice. I have had many decades of experience with choirs, and they don't go home and practice most of the time. Well, I came back for the funeral to do the service, and the choir had practiced wonderfully, and they sounded beautiful. I was very shocked and pleased and surprised and happy, and we gave Rose a beautiful send-off, I thought. And then Debbie and I became friends after that. It was Sue Jean Suttinger, actually, in my mind's eye, hired me. And then we started to work together. And Debbie and I have had a good working relationship, although sometimes we're looking at each other like this occasionally. We occasionally have disagreements about tempo. But that's normal. That's normal. The wonderful thing is, as nasty as I could have been, Debbie never was. When I started teaching here, I just came from teaching at Suitland High School for 13 years, and you had to have a little bit of force in order to get your point across to the students, who were very vocal about their opinions as well and what they wanted to do. And to have that force to control them had to be kind of big, and it had to be kind of loud. And I didn't realize when I got here that I had carried that over. And so the Pilgrim Church Choir, when they first met me, I was a taskmaster. Jim Fay thought I was way too mean to everybody. He said, oh, he's a meanie, isn't he? He's terrible. but that's okay. Together, that wore off, I hope. Did it wear off some, folks? Okay, it wore off some. Oh, Bob says, no, it never wore off. You're a beast, always a beast. But Debbie has always had the ability to calm me down and to let me trust not to worry about things, that it's going to happen. It's going to work. And that's because this church is so wonderful and preparing and celebrating our members and celebrating each other. And so Debbie and I have been working now for 20 years. This will be our 21st Christmas, or my 21st Christmas. And the entire time that we have worked together, I don't know, have we ever had any harsh words? Maybe from me, I guess, but never from Debbie. We've gotten along very well. And I have to tell you some musical attributes that Debbie has that not everybody has. I don't know if any of you know, or some of you I know do know, what sight reading is. Sight reading is where you take a piece of music and you put it in front of somebody's face and they play it. That's not as easy as it sounds. I mean, you're thinking, well, if you put a play of Shakespeare in front of somebody, they can just read the lines. It's not like that at all. I mean, especially on the organ, she's got her feet going. How you keep track of that, I have no idea. Your left hand, right hand, going at the same time. What stops are going, listening to the choir, trying to watch me conduct. Being an accompanist is an incredibly difficult job. And she's more than that. She's our music director. But she winds up being my accompanist, or the choir's accompanist, rather, more often than not. And she's proven to be an excellent accompanist. But with regards to that sight reading that I was talking about, there really hasn't been a piece of music that I've sat down in front of her that she couldn't play. And believe me, I've tried. Yes, indeed. I've stuck some Beethoven in front of her. Oh, some Moses Hogan spirituals that are so difficult rhythmically to play, and et cetera. And she works hard on it, and she's always gotten it. And she's always supported everything I've done, everything the choir has done. And I also have to tell you, I am in awe of what she did when we took our two trips to Europe. The choir went in 2006, we went to Germany and the Czech Republic. And then in 2008, we went to Austria and the Czech Republic once again. The instruments that they showed her that she was going to have to play, well, unbelievable. I need to wrap things up. But nonetheless, she would be given some instruments to play at churches, and I had no idea how she was going to accomplish it. And I've played organ myself, but there was, especially St. Stephen's. I don't know, it was a box, and it had a pull lever here. And I really have no idea how you played that instrument. And she played Mozart on it. She played everything on it. It's amazing to me. So through two wonderful trips, if you want to hear her playing, and hear the choir, we still have plenty of our CDs left over. And you should take one and get Debbie to sign it for you. And that will be a wonderful souvenir in memory of Debbie. So we are so happy to have had you. I'm so happy to have had you. And since I've moved up here, I've become much closer to so many members, and you all have no idea what Debbie's done for me. Feed the kitties, hospital, all kinds of things. You have no idea. And she's been a wonderful friend, and I appreciate that, and I'm going to miss you. I'm going to end before I cry. Bye.
I first met Debbie about 30 years ago in this church, right about the third row from the back on this side. I was sitting there with my two children, who were then three and five, I think. And of course, you know, as young children tend to be, they were a little bit rambunctious. And in comes this lovely lady here with her well-behaved 11-year-old, and sits in the same pew with me. And I felt compelled to apologize to her for their behavior and found out that she was scoping us out. I don't know at that point if she'd actually been hired or she was considering it, but she was there to check out the church and check us out. And that was when I first met her. And now, 30 years later, my kids are youngish adults. Her 11-year-old, Natalie, as you all saw this morning, is all grown up and has two lovely young sons. So a lot has happened in 30 years, a lot. We have a video that will be played in the fellowship hall after the service. It has excerpts from all kinds of stuff that we've done over the years with Debbie. And, you know, she has always been the rock of our choir. She is so dependable. She's always there. She's always in good humor. She, you know, she was never griping or groaning. She was always in a good mood. Like Michael said, she can sight read anything. It's astounding. She can sight read anything. She's so fantastic and so musical. I mean, anything you give her, any style, she can play it. You know, I don't know if you know this about her. You may not have looked at her feet, but Debbie has very small feet. Okay. I think you're a size 6, right, Debbie? Oh, you're 7 now. Well, she was 6 at one point. Our feet get bigger as we get older. But anyway, in spite of her small feet, we are going to have very large shoes to fill with her leaving. Debbie, We got this for you, something you can hold on and remember. And there is an inscription on it. It says, to Deborah Houston, in recognition of 30 years service, our love and thanks, Pilgrim Church 2023.
Thank you. Oh, Roberta, that was so sweet.
Thank you.
May God bless you and keep you. May God make God's face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God lift up God's countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.